So hello everybody to the next talk. It's about extent and how you can do model transformation in very large projects with the extent based tooling. To get an idea about where everybody is in terms of extent, who of you has already been using extent? Okay. And who of you has already done model transformations? Okay, a perfect audience. Wonderful. Okay, nonetheless, I will have one or two slight introductory slides that give a general idea about extent. So I just copied the blurb from the web page, and it says, extent is a flexible and expressive dialect of Java, which compiles into Java source code, and you can integrate any Java library seamlessly. Actually, that is true. It's very high level. Many of you have seen extent, and it's a nice programming language. But what's totally missing in the blurb is what makes extent actually very cool for modeling. So in extent, we have specific language features for model-to-model transformation. We have language features for model-to-text transformation. The syntax, the lambdas are much nicer than using plain Java. We have a very interesting feature called active annotations that makes it easy for you to extend what the language actually does in terms of annotations. And it has a very nice and concise syntax. So, we have been using extent in a large project in the automotive industry, and I will give you a little bit of an overview first about the project. I cannot name the company, but it's a big automotive company, OEM, so one of the big ones. And the data for the software in the car is actually distributed over a number of databases. So you could imagine there might be some Oracle database where they store what messages are transferred within the car. There might be one database that could be a totally different format, maybe a binary file that contains what diagnostic information is relevant in the car. And then there might be a UML or a SysML model that contains information about the structure of the software architecture. And what usually happens is, because automotive companies, they don't build the little computers themselves, they pass that information to a so-called first tier. That would be someone like Bosch, Conti, TRW. And they get all these separate data, and then they have to make sense of that data and make a consistent software and a consistent computer out of that car computer. But nobody really is sure that these data actually fits together. So what happens is that the OEM, the first tier, constantly gets back to the company, says, does this really fit together? We don't understand how it relates. And to solve that problem, the car company wanted to make a change. Instead of having the first tier doing all the work, they are merging the data they have in a consolidated model that is actually not any silos anymore. It's a consistent data model. And from that model, they create a so-called AUTOSAR model. AUTOSAR is a model standard, a software description standard in the automotive industry. And they pass that model on actually then to the tier one, to the supplier, reducing the integration effort so that there's less questions, there's higher quality, etc., etc. So an actually high level sketch, that's what we did. Huge models, so there is one. Each of these models describes a computer in your car, could be infotainment unit, motor control unit. It's easily several hundred thousands model elements that are being generated and transformed. And all that has been done on Xtend. So I think it's probably one of the largest Xtend model projects that we know. So right now, I did a count this morning. It's 380,000 lines of code, roughly. This is Xtend code. And the interesting part is, what does it mean, 380,000 lines of Xtend code? Because as many of you might know, who've already had experience writing model transformation queries, etc., is much nicer in Xtend than it is in Java. So, for example, assume that we have a software component, and a software component has a port, and we want to find out all the data that is sent from the system from the software. So we have to query the model, go from a software component to all its ports, and find which data is sent in the software description over these ports. And I have two code fragments for you. On the top, we don't have to go into the detail, but on the top you see what such a code would look like in classic Java. So you would start at the top of the model, and then you have a tree iterator, and then you have a for loop going over the entire models, instance of to find all the software components, then casts, then from the software components getting all the data prototypes, etc., etc. So you have a lot of loops. And exactly the same code is written at the bottom of the slide in Xtend. So it's much conciser because it uses the Lambda syntax, it uses the concatenated syntax, and you can just easily filter. And a lot of the typecasting that is required in Java is already easily available in Xtend. So the syntax alone, the language alone of Xtend, makes it very nice to navigate models and is a perfect candidate for model-based tooling. Now, obviously, this is Java 7, the code above. In Java 8, we have a new concept called streams and lambdas. So you could argue, I don't need that. In Java 8, I have streams and lambdas. And we tried to make an example of how it would look like if you use Java 8. And without going into it, all the yellow marked code would be what you could or what you would not need if you would write it in Xtend. So again, there's a lot of casting. There's a few tricks that you could do to reduce that, to write your own library, but that library would be also already provided by Xtend. So actually, we started out in the project as a convention to have a mix of Java and Xtend, and use Xtend only for the model-to-model transformation. And the customer is doing some development as well. But after 2 or 3 months, that guideline was actually thrown out through the window because everybody thought Xtend is so much more productive to write. And none of the code was actually written in Java anymore, so everybody switched to writing Xtend. So, and we have some general patterns, some general problems in model-to-model transformation that are also addressed by Xtend in terms of the core language. And I will briefly introduce that problem. Many of you are model-to-model experts already. So assume that we are doing a model transformation from one model on the left, could be UML, to another model on the right, could be AUTOSAR model. And assume that we have two model elements, C and I, which are in a container, and the C element also has a sub-element, a port, could be a component and a port, contains a port, and there is a reference from P to I. So now what would happen if you do a model-to-model transformation? The code would have maybe start from the root, look at O, do a transformation, create O dash, then would do a depth-based iteration, have a look at C, do a transformation of C, then do P and do a transformation of to P dash. But at this point, to do the transformation, it would already have to know to what target element P dash has to point, because P references I, P dash needs to reference I dash. So at this point in time, I dash is not there yet. So I would have, basically there are two strategies. The one is, if you come by such a reference, create I dash, put it in a cache, and remember that you created it, and then when you pass by through the depth first iteration to actually get this out of the cache and set the link then. The other approach is to do a two-pass transformation. So let's first create all the containment structure, keep a map of what's been created, and then do a second pass and resolve all the references in the target model. So if you don't have a framework for that, that means that you have to keep a lot of caches. It's a very, very complicated or a little bit of annoying stuff. You have a lot of caches, et cetera, et cetera. So the two strategies are basically doing a multi-pass transformation, which is not nice from terms of code architecture, or to keep custom caches, which is a lot of manual code management, which you could actually delegate to something like a DSL. And Extend actually has built-in support for that use case, which is not widely known, but it's very nice. So Extend has the so-called create methods. So def is this general keyword for defining a method. And then there's a create statement. And then you have a statement on how to instantiate a new element. That could be, for example, T interface, so an interface in the target meta model. And you have the actual arguments, so that would be the source model. And then you can say, okay, how the names are set, the attributes are set. And then what happens is that for these kinds of statements, Extend actually automatically manages the cache under the hood. So the first time you would call this method for a given interface, it would say, okay, I've never been called for this interface, so create me a new target interface and execute the method body. So then the second time it would be called, it would look up its internal cache and say, I've already been called for that argument, I don't need to do anything anymore, I'll be just passing the arguments, the result from the prior invocation. And that means that during the code transformation, you don't actually have to care about order of transformation or cache management anymore. You just could call, for example, okay, the target interface is the mapped source interface, or you could say my own element in O is just one of the mapped elements. And the order is not important anymore because it's all managed under the hood. And that makes the transformation easily manageable. And it's very nice to have your code like that. And it gives us another advantage, which is not actually foreseen by the creators, but which we are making heavy use of. It's a question of analyzing the model. So let me go back a step. In this case, the source model and the target model are structurally very similar. So if I have some strange thing here in P dash, I can easily find out the source element P because it's structurally so similar that it's very trivial. But very often this is not the case. So this is a use case where the structures might be totally different. So suddenly I don't have I and P anymore, I have three new elements of this kind and two elements of the other kind. And now it really gets, if I find a target model problem here, it really gets difficult to find out what the source problem is. But if you remember, the create statements actually keep the cache of what model element has been created in the target from the source. So what we do is, after the transformation is done, we use actually Java reflection to find all the caches. And then we have additional elements in the target element, which is just a text element maybe, and we attach information about the source elements. So every element knows where it's been coming from. And so if we find a problem in the target model, it's very easy to identify what the source model is. This makes analysis much easier. And we use dependency injection to create our transformations so we easily can find all the caches. So this also works in several levels. If I go by back to the original slide, we use that tracing for the transformation to the consolidated model, and we use the tracing as well to the final model. And now the benefit is, if the supplier finds a problem in the AUTOSAR model, he easily knows, he can easily give information about, okay, I have a problem here, and your tool says, your model says, the data comes actually from database A. So the automotive company doesn't have to do debugging to see where the data came from. They can easily just say, okay, I'll go back to A without doing a reverse tracking. So we've been using the standard feature of the create statements and actually been leveraging the architecture behind to do all the tracing information here. One of the next features that we're using is active annotations. Active annotations is a way to actually influence and enhance the way that the extend compiler transforms extend files to Java files. So we have an extend source file, and there's the extend compiler, and he transforms the files to Java, and you can influence that behavior through active annotations. So you define a new annotation, for example, the simple example, we defined a new annotation called log, and then you implement a so-called annotation processor, which is being called by the extend compiler every time that he finds the annotation log in the extend files. And to give you an idea how that would look like, he would invoke a method called doTransform and gives you information about the class, the internal representation of the class where the annotation has been found. And then he would actually say, okay, now I attach or I add another field to that class, the name of that new field would be logger, and then we would create a new logger field here, which would be true, static, it's final, it got a certain type, and we can also define the initializer or the statement. So just by adding a add log to a certain class, we immediately have logging for log4j, and we can easily change the framework that, or the way that's being logged, not by changing every class file that uses logging, but just by changing the annotation. So logging is one of the mostly cited use cases for active annotations, but we've been doing a few different things. Because our transformations are quite huge. So we have added a so-called add transformation where we generate documentation out of. So for all our source codes, we analyze which elements of the target meta model are actually created in which part of the transformation and create a table, an Excel table or an HTML table for that. So you could see in our table that if I want to get an idea where the target metamodel element T component is created, I could easily see that it is created in these methods and which arguments those methods have. So it's a very nice way for documenting what the system does and finding code that is specific to a certain transformation. And then we have Word documents that actually specify the transformations that we do to a better or lesser degree. And we use the same annotation or the same concept to do tracing. So we have a requirements annotation now, and there we specify for classes and for methods which requirement chapter of the specification it is using. So we have the requirement annotation directly in the source code, and then we generate another table where we can actually directly see which class and which method is actually responsible for a given transformation. So these are some of the features that are actively used in the transformations. But writing transformations in Xtend has also some more advantages as compared to other technologies. And that's why I want to go back to the blurb that we had before, which said Xtend is a flexible and expressive dialect of Java, and it compiles directly to Java. And actually, that turned out to be a major benefit for us when writing transformations. So at the beginning of the project, we had a short evaluation, should we do our transformation in QVTO, which is an interpreted transformation language, which is an OMG standard. So we were thinking, okay, is that what we want? And we did an evaluation between QVTO and Xtend. And at that time, QVTO had some problems with the EMF metamodel that we had, and it also had not so good performance. So we went for Xtend. And during the project, actually, the compatibility of Xtend with Java turned out to be one of the best things that we could have for a real production-like business-critical transformation system. Because, for example, since it all compiles to Java, our transformation compiles to Java, we can directly use JUnit to test our transformation. So we have a huge number of test cases simply written in JUnit, so we can actually test all the aspects of our transformations. That also means that we can use the Java code coverage tools. Our transformations are actually tested with ECLMR or Chacoco, and we have a nice report in the nightly build about our test coverage for the transformation. That's you need more effort if you have interpreted tools. We get perfect documentation for our transformation as long as the programmer is writing it with JavaDoc. So perfect, just the same tooling. We can use the Maven plugins for JavaDoc, and we have one documentation for the parts that have been written in Java in our system, as well as for the parts that are written in Xtend. If you do profiling, if you have an interpreted language, you need a specific profiler to find out where the bottleneck is. Our transformation methods can be profiled by YorkKit or JProfile or whatever, because you're actually profiling on the Java level. And that's a very nice feature if you want to find out where you have any bottlenecks, etc. Same goes for memory analysis. We had a situation where it just sucked up a lot of memory, and we used JMAT to find out all the problems in the model transformation. Two more things, or a few more things. Maven, it integrates with Maven, Surefire, etc. It's very nice to build and test that. You don't need any special Maven plugins. It has perfect EMF support because it works on the directly on the Java API of our EMF models. And we had a problem, I think it was with QVTO and nullable enumerations, because there's a QVTO uses its own layer to access EMF and wasn't prepared for all the oddities that we had in our EMF models. And another very important feature for us is that we can directly interface to Java libraries. So in our transformation, we had complex queries. We needed to find out which data transmission units are on the same ECU but not sending the same data, and we just used jgraph-t for that. So we created an internal representation of the information that we wanted in jgraph, and then it's just a snap of telling jgraph, give me all the disconnected subgraphs. And it's simple. Also, we have situations where we need to find out certain permutations of elements in the transformation, and you can use any Java-based code for that. In addition, since our transformations are quite complex, putting together the pieces with dependency injection is very nice. So we use Google Juice to build up all the transformation, which is also a little bit more difficult if you're using an interpreted language. In addition to that, Guava has a very nice library, so we use a lot of the helper classes from Guava, like BMap, etc., what's not in there, which makes data management much nicer. And so these are all a lot of the factors that we found very, very usable and very beneficial when using Xtend for model transformations. Yeah, so this is the coverage of what specific features Xtend provides for model-to-model transformation. Right now we have about, I think each night, about almost already 90 ECUs. So the computers that are in the car, the data for over 90 ECUs is nightly generated based on this framework. So Carsten and I had yesterday, we had a talk, and he told me he's wondering that we're not in more contact because we are one of the power users of Xtend. But the thing, it's very stable. It's extremely stable. We don't encounter any bugs in Xtend. That's very good. So, I mean, there's obviously you have a little bit of a performance impact because it compiles all those files, but it's amazingly stable, and we are all very happy with the tooling. And so thanks for all the Xtend committers that are in the room, and to all those that are not in the room too. And so I'm up for your questions that you might have on our experiences with Xtend. So thanks. Yeah.
We have similar experiences with Xtend that you have demonstrated, but we have also some kind of issues, like some quality issues.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if you use Xtend, you deploy some Java tool to measure like code coverage.
Okay.
And it's not always straightforward. What to map to what and how, and there are also problems if we execute, for example, Finebox, for example, and we find some parts in Xtend code.
So actually, we don't use Finebox on the generator. Use Finebox on the generated Java code. With the code coverage, I don't know if you're using the feature. There is actually a feature in the code coverage plugins that you can have the code coverage based on the Xtend lines and not on the Java lines. And that makes it very nice to see then in the code coverage report.
Yeah, but what I mean is that when I look at the generated code, I see that there are elements in the classes created, for example, for YAR 8.
Ah, okay, yeah.
Actually, it's not instruction coverage that measures.
No, that's true, yeah. So it's a little bit, I mean, it depends on what kind of coverage or expectations you have. it's for our use case, it's okay. And also sometimes if you have like the statement that I showed on one line, there's a lot of code on one line. So for coverage, you might maybe even break it down to several other lines.
In some cases, especially in this domain, there are sometimes requirements on quality are really important.
Mm-hmm.
Like we have to present that, show us how you manage that, there's no such and such metrics violated.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You have to get tricky writing extent code, you have to sometimes know what will be generated that is
yeah. Okay. Yeah, that might be. I mean, we can also talk to the extent guys how stuff is generated. So I don't know if you already had a discussion, but Christian and Carsten and others are at the ITEMIS booth, so I think they would also be happy to learn about the experiences. There was I'm blinded. There was a question in the back. Yes. Yes. So that would have been a good. I didn't put that in. That would have been an idea. So there is actually, for example, if you create a new model element in plain Java, you would say create instance blah blah, and then a dot attribute one is b, a dot attribute b is da da da, and actually you can shortcut this with extend. So I had this on a. Maybe we can do it offline afterwards. I had it basically as a intended pun on the first slide. So there is the equals larger operator, and that is similar to what have been with in Pascal. So you have an attribute before, and so for example you might create an UML class in your transformation. And then with this operator, everything in the bracket is actually scoped to the element that you have before. But I can easily show you some piece of code where you can see that. But that's a valid point. Even creating the model gets much more comfortable with the extend syntax. Yeah. Any further questions? We have 1 or 2 minutes. Otherwise, as I mentioned, Carsten, Christian, I, and others are at the ITEMIS booth. Just come by if you want to discuss extend. We would really enjoy the discussion. Okay, thank you very much.